Thank you, Vasilis, and I'm very happy to be there. So I will talk about the dark matter puzzle, as you see, and to introduce the topic. As you see, we can now see the dark matter, even if it is dark and it does not radiate. We see it by gravitational lensing, and I just put, as an introduction, two beautiful images of the space telescope, where you see a galaxy cluster and you see arcs. And these arcs, as we'll develop in the seminar here, are galaxies in the background that are deformed, have deformation due to the mass of the cluster is deflecting light. And when there is on the same line of sight a galaxy making the lens, you can have an Einstein ring, which is an exceptional strong lensing. But you have also a very weak lensing, and that's why you can derive the matter that you don't see. So let's begin here. We have now some figures. We have established some figures that I will give you some history about that. But just to put the scene here, here is the content of the universe. So we have ordinary matter that is in this table and so on, which are protons, neutrons, that we call baryons. So baryons, surprisingly, is only 5% of the content of the universe, while the dark matter that we are the subject of this seminar here is 25% of the content of the universe, so there is a factor 5 between the two. And there is also a huge content, which is dark energy, which is not the topic of this conference here, but we have to know it anyway. And all this, we put this density of the universe as a function of the critical density. Just to give you a number, because it's important, you see that the average density of the universe is 10 to the minus 29 gram per cubic centimeter, which means that the universe is very diffuse and void, if you want. And we compute, in general, all the densities, baryons, dark matter, and dark energy, in terms of this omega, which is without a dimension, with just a relation between the true density and this critical one. But just to remind you that it is almost a void, the universe. So baryons, dark matter, and dark energy. Now I make a little bit history, for how much time we know that there is dark matter. In fact, we can cite two examples, because and we'll see until the end of this hour, that when you see matter, you don't know if it is invisible matter or if you have to change gravity. And this, in the history, you have an example by Le Verrier, who discovered, by the perturbations, gravitational perturbation on the planets, he discovered, well, the planets are disturbed, and I don't see why. And he was very clever enough to discover that there was another planet. And by the computation, he said, this must be at this place, and very quickly it was discovered by Johannes Gehl. And this put a lot of glory on Le Verrier, of course. But this means that this invisible matter was really matter. And he tried to do the same experiment when it was discovered that Mercury has an orbit which was not elliptical, but which was precessing. It was a precessing of the perihelion of Mercury. And of course, Le Verrier wanted to see another planet. He called it Vulcan because it's very near the Sun. And as you know, it was not a planet. And they make the observation that during an eclipse, and there was a disappointment. But soon after, it was discovered by Einstein that you had to change the gravity. That is, general relativity. It means that gravity is not a force, but a distortion of space. And this change of gravity was the explanation of this perturbation on Mercury. So you see two examples where this invisible matter is either matter or a change of gravity, and we have this kind of choice now. So people trace back to the first astronomer who talked about dark matter. It was Fritz Zwicky, a Swiss astronomer that worked in California. And in 1937, he looked at this galaxy cluster, coma cluster, an ensemble of galaxies, and he measured with the spectrum the velocity of the galaxy by the Doppler effect, like a radar measure the velocity of cars. Here you can measure the velocity of galaxies. And they are very speedy, 1,000 kilometers per second. And if you look at the visible matter, which is made of galaxies, stars, and gas, and so on, it's very a tiny part of the mass necessary to bind the cluster and to retain the galaxy together. So he ends up with the surprising result that the mass-to-light ratio of the cluster is 500 times the same mass-to-light of a star, like a sun. So it means that you have at least 100 times more mass than the visible mass. It's huge effect. The invisible mass dominates by a large effect. So he already proposed that either there is dark matter in galaxies or in between, or there is also some obscuration by dust that you don't see all the visible matter. But he also have the same idea that maybe you have to change the law of gravity already at this epoch. But finally, Zwicky, as you see, he had a very bad character. And he was had an attitude very contemptuous to his colleagues. He was treating these colleagues of idiots, stupid, and even spherically stupid, because whatever the direction you see them, they are stupid. So he was not believed. In fact, nobody believed his theory of dark matter. That's why it took still 40 years to believe. In fact, we believe in 78 or 30. Here, even he was not believing in the Big Bang, and he was not believing in the rotation of galaxies. So he had very special character. Jan Oort, in 32, was finding also invisible mass in the galaxy, because he looked at the velocity of stars and see that they had much larger velocity than expected from the visible mass. So there was also a problem here. And as I said, you have to wait until maybe 78, after 37. So you see that the Zwicky was not really followed. And you have the fantastic work of Vera Rubin, who was very perseverant, because nobody believed that there was dark matter. So she traced a lot of rotation curves, thousands of rotation curves of early-type galaxies, late-type galaxies. But it was very difficult, because you see some rotation curve. Here it's a radius and the velocity. And there was a lot of error bars. For those who are not knowing what is rotation curve, here is a rotation curve. So what we do here, you see a galaxy is like a disk which is in rotation with parallel arms, and part of it is rotating this way, away from you, and part is going towards you. And of course, like the Doppler effect, here the radiation is shifted to the red. You see the spectrum here, and the radiation here is shifted to the blue. So you have the velocity plus, minus, and zero in the center. And you can, at each point, at each radius, you can plot the velocity, linear velocity, as a function of radius here for a galaxy. Okay? And for instance, for our own galaxy here, our own galaxy is represented here. Of course, it's an artist's view because we are inside the galaxy. But we know that it should look like this. There is a bar and spiral structure. And the sun is not at the center. It's about here. So the sun is at about 10 kiloparsec. I will speak about this unit. Parsec is 3 light years, and kiloparsec is 3,000 light years. And the sun is here, so it's not at the end of the optical disk. And you see the observation of the velocity, 200 kilometers per second for the sun, for instance. And you can try to explain it either by the bulge. You have a bulge here, and it will correspond to this velocity, and a disk, it will correspond to this. So all the visible mass will correspond to this. And you expect, of course, that the velocity goes down when there is no longer any mass. And finally, it is not what you observe. You observe the flat rotation curve. But of course, here, given the error bars, it was not yet convincing. Now, when you discover the radiation of atomic hydrogen is a main component of the universe, the main gas component. There's a little helium and other traces, but hydrogen is the main component. We call it H1 because it's the first element, H1 neutral hydrogen. And there is a hyperfine structure with a fundamental line, 21 centimeters in radio. And what you measure here, for instance, for M83, which is an optical galaxy like a barn and so on, It is very small with respect to the huge size of the galaxy. The galaxy is huge in neutral hydrogen. So you have like a reservoir of gas that will fall with a small velocity to the center, and then it will fuel the galaxy in gas to form new stars. But then the gas is a very good tracer to know the rotation curve, because the gas is only a few percent of the mass, is negligible, it's like test particles. But you see the rotation curve of the gas, because it's a line, you can have a Doppler effect also. And you see, even if the sun is here, you can go much further and the velocity is not going down, but it's flat. And this, you are obliged to believe that there is dark matter. So it's only in this kind of 70s and 80s that people finally were convinced, not from Fritz Wicke, but convinced that dark matter is here. And there was, if I follow the history, there was another event which was very interesting in 1960 that we observed also in other wavelengths. I've shown you optical, radio, but then you have the higher energy X-ray. And to observe X-ray, you have to go in space because the atmosphere is absorbing. So there was some first X-ray satellite in the 60s and 70s. And they pointed to the Coma cluster that we have seen Frank Zwicky finding such a large invisible mass. And surprisingly, there was a lot of gas, a lot of hot gas radiating in X-ray at 100 million degrees. So it's really a plasma, ionized gas. And the surprise is that the mass is larger than the galaxies. So all the visible mass, the baryons, the ordinary matter, is in the shape of ionized gas that Wicke could not see. So at least you have resolved part of the dark matter puzzle of Zwicky. But at some point, there was some error bars at the beginning. We thought, well, we have seen all the dark matter, but not, in fact, because finally, you gain a factor 10. So instead of 100, you have a factor 10 missing. And now we see that I've shown you that was a 5%, 25%. So you can have a factor 5 or 6. But there remains some dark matter. So it's not the dark matter, but at least we have seen some matter that was not in the in our view, direct view, optical view. And then, well, of course, clusters, we see a lot of more baryons, but it's not a lot of mass in the universe. The cluster is only a few percent of the mass of the universe. So what we want to know is, what is the density of the whole universe? Is there a lot of dark matter in the whole universe? And to have the density of universe, you have to look at the curvature. Because as the general relativity equation of Einstein at 1915 said, that is the fate of the universe and the geometry is linked to the density of matter and energy which is in the universe. So you have three cases, for instance, represented schematically, very schematically here. That is, we represent the universe at two dimensions. So you imagine that universe is only the surface of a sphere, for instance. So if omega, that the density of the universe in average, is larger than the critical density, larger than one. For instance, in this diagram, you have, as a function of time, the size of the universe. We are here now. And if you have omega 5, for instance, then after the Big Bang, the expansion of the Big Bang, the gravity of the universe is decelerating the expansion, and there is a big crunch, okay? You have the big crunch here. If it is not so dense that it is exactly in equilibrium here, you can have an expansion parabolic. And if it is very low, you have a negative curvature that we represent by saddle here, and then it can go forever. But now we have discovered the dark energy in 1998, and this exactly at the end of it. There was a problem at the end of the 20th century here, because we measured the mass by the gravity of galaxy clusters and so on, and we found only 0.1. Why? There was clues that the curvature of the universe was zero, that the universe is flat, and I will show you why. In fact, the main information came with the vestige of the radiation of the Big Bang here that is in the microwave. Why it is in the microwave? In fact, in the Big Bang, you have very hot and dense universe, millions of degrees, and then in the expansion, it is becoming colder and colder. now we see this radiation, the vestige of the Big Bang, we see at 3 degrees Kelvin, which means that it radiates like a black body in millimeter wavelength, so microwave, millimeter, 2 millimeter. And then we call it CMB, okay? And what we see, and maybe you have seen plenty of these images like this, it's a Planck satellite image. We have the sky in the millimeter wavelength, and you see the anisotropies of the CMB, which is more hot in the orange region, colder in blue. We have the impression that it is noise, but it is not noise. It is the fluctuations that will be that will make the structure of the universe, the clusters and the galaxies. And when you put each pixel here as a value, you put all the pixels with a certain size, and you put it in this curve. The power at each size, here you have 0.1 degree, 0.2, 1 degree, and so on. And you see this. It's not noise at all. In fact, when you see that, the error bars are put here. You see that you don't see the error bars since it is so precise. And from this, what are these oscillations? In fact, they are the reflection of what the universe is at the beginning. This structure is the last diffraction of the photons, the light. And it is 400,000 years after the Big Bang. And after this epoch, you have the photons, the radiation, are in equilibrium with the baryons, the ordinary matter. And then you have acoustic oscillation, the sound. And of course, the sound, you have several scales. The biggest scales here, 1 degree, is the path that the sound has been run from the Big Bang to 400,000 years. And this, we know exactly the size of this path, because we know the speed of the sound in a plasma, and we know, so we can use this by a ruler, and it's exactly what we do, and I want to put this figure just to convince you why the universe is flat, because it's just a geometrical explanation, and it can be explained very quickly here. You see, we have this standard ruler, which is the path of the sound from the Big Bang to the 400,000 years, and that, if you see, the observer is here, if you see the photons are traveling in a straight line, it means that the universe is flat, okay? And you will see this ruler in 1 degree, is exactly what you see. If you have a negative curvature, you will see the gray line, and the angle will be smaller, so you will see the maximum at the difference. And when you see this, it's completely well precisely seen, and you can deduce that the universe is flat, okay? So this is very interesting for us, because then the curvature is the sum of this omega, dark energy and dark matter, and we have now a very precise measurement of the dark matter, 25%, I told you at the beginning, and it is a concordance between a lot of observations, but this CMB is one of them. And it gives you also the age of the universe.
Sorry, what's the deviation of omega from one to this galaxy?
What is the?
What's the possible deviation of omega from one just from looking at this graph?
Yes, in fact, we have about a few percent. I'm not exactly the figure. The precision of omega, you mean from?
Like plus minus 3%, for example.
Something like that, yeah. It's very precise. And we have also other experiments like lensing, gravitational lensing, that confirm this. So it's not only this. There is supernovae, there is, I will maybe try to tell you something like that. So I told you at the beginning that we are able now to make a map, a cartography of the dark matter. Dark matter is not a right word. I would say it's not interacting with photons, so it's not radiating and so on. But I would prefer transparent, because there is maybe a lot of dark matter in this room and you don't see it. So it's not dark, it's transparent. Okay? So this transparent matter, how do we cartograph a map of this? By gravitational lenses. I've shown you this cluster with strong lenses, but all the galaxies that are behind the cluster are deformed there. And there is here a way to show that here. You see that if the background galaxies were all small circles, of course it would be easy, because you have the deformation will be intrinsically known at once. Of course, in the center you have a strong arc. But of course, the galaxies have different shapes. Sometimes there are disks that are edge-on. So you see here a disk edge-on and so on. So only in a statistical manner you can derive the shear. Shear meaning that you distort the shape of the galaxy which is behind. And you see that now we are able to have millions of galaxies behind and to measure statistically the deformation. So it's a tracer of the mass. So now we are able to plot a map of the whole matter, which is in blue here. And from all the deformation, in each pixel you have deformation. So you have this blue map, which is a dark matter. And here you have the in red the hot gas from the X-ray satellite, Chandra, for instance, which is the main baryonic component. As I told you, for instance, in coma, you have 10 times more mass in the hot gas than in the galaxies. So you can neglect the galaxies at the first approximation. So when you try to superpose the visible and the total mass, you see that there is a good correspondence. Well, there are some error bars, of course, but here you have a void here, an empty space, and it is empty as well as in the baryonic matter and the dark matter. So both matter are tightly related. This is a point. If you want to modify gravity, for instance, this is a positive point. Here you have also a good relation at the scale of galaxies. It was here clusters of galaxies. Now it's galaxies. Here you have a relation between the velocity of the flat portion of the rotation curve, which is a measurement of the dark matter. So you can have a proxy for dark matter here. And here you have the mass of the baryons, that is the luminosity of the stars plus the gas. And you see that there is a very good correlation. Each point is a galaxy. And each time you have a good correlation between the dark matter content of the galaxy and its baryonic matter. This was used for an indicator of distance, but now it is used, as I will show, to constrain any model of modified gravity, for instance. And then, what is this dark matter? And of course, we are helped in this by numerical simulation. In numerical simulation, we can reconstruct the universe from the start. We know that we have the fluctuations that I've shown you by the CMB. We know the initial condition of the universe, and now we have just to put this initial condition in the computer, and just by gravity, because gravity is the essential point, you add the gravity and body code, and then you have the universe. Okay? For the moment, you ignore stars for the moment. The dark matter is the main component, and then what you find is these kind of things. So, if the dark matter was hot, warm, or cold. What is the temperature of dark matter? That means that when you have a small mass, like a neutrino, neutrinos have a little mass, very small, electron volt, but they are very small. And when they decouple from the expansion, they are relativistic because they're small mass. And relativistic means that they are very hot. They make a pressure and they prevent the small scale to collapse. So if you have hot dark matter model, neutrinos, you don't see any small-scale structure. You see only very large filaments, but no grains, no clumps. If you have a CDM, cold dark matter model, here you see that you have not only the filaments. The initial conditions were the same, so the location of the filaments are the same. You have the same filaments, but then it is a lot of clumps. Okay, and this is due to the fact that it is a big, massive particle, much more massive than the proton. And then it is not relativistic at the beginning, so it does not prevent the formation of small structure, and the worm is in middle. So here are some examples of this numerical simulation. For instance, the Millennium Run, there are many, many more with billions of particles. I think the record is 2,000 billions of particles, making by Romain Tessier in Zurich. And here you see there are zooms here. You see a lot of filaments. You can zoom here, and at the crossing of the filament, you have this cluster of galaxies. And the main point is that when you make a simulation with cold dark matter, CDM, here in red it is simulation, And here is observation. You compare observation in blue with simulation in red. In the observation, each point is a galaxy. So you don't see here the dark matter, but you trace the dark matter in the filaments because of the galaxies that follow the filaments. Okay? And you see that, indeed, they look the same, at least the large-scale structure and the finger of God here and so on. It is very satisfying. The CDM is a very good model at large scale. You find about the same kind of structure. We find some problems, I will show them, but it is at small scale. At large scale, it's perfect. The CDM is a very good model. Now, it's a very good model, but we have no particle. That's a big problem. And for a while, in fact, we realized only in 1985 that the invisible matter had to be non-bionic. Before, even for Zwicky, for Vera Rubin, and so on, all the dark matter was bionic. There was no other matter. In 1985, we realized, and I will explain you if you ask, why there cannot be invisible matter, the 25% must be non-bionic. So what are these particles? And the main candidate was this neutralino coming from the supersymmetric hypothesis. You have a standard model of particles, which are quarks and also leptons and neutrinos and electronic tau and mu and so on. But all these are fermions, and you have no candidate of dark matter in the standard model of particles. So you imagine that there is symmetrical, supersymmetric particles, which are bosons. Bosons correspond to fermions. And then you have the most stable particle in this supersymmetric world will be the neutralino. And the neutralino, we think that we know the mass. Why? Because it's not sufficient to have a candidate. You must have the physics to have exactly 25% remaining today. And this is not obvious, because these bosons, this particle that we hypothetic particle, neutralino, they are their own antiparticle. So at the beginning, you form the same number of particle antiparticle, and they annihilate. They annihilate with a certain cross-section, which must be the weak force, because there is not, for the moment, fifth force. Well, we'll see later. And then they annihilate, we know the cross-section, and it depends also, the number that will remain depends also on the mass of the particle. So if we have 100 GeV, meaning that you have 100 times the proton mass is 1 GeV, let's say, to give an order of magnitude. So if you have 100 times the mass of the proton, it works very well. That's what we call the miracle here, because here you see the number of particles as a function of time. The beginning, you have a lot of annihilation, so the number is going down. And then what happens is that the universe is expanding. So the particles don't see each other. The time to collide and to annihilate is larger than the Hubble time. So they don't annihilate. And what is remaining is what we call the relic abundance. And the relic abundance, of course, here, it depending on this mass. So to have exactly 25% of mass, you need to have this mass, 100 GeV. And this is a problem, because in CERN, as you know, LHC, we are reproducing the Big Bang condition. We are colliding proton, antiproton, and this gives at the particle level enough energy to create a lot of particles. Like in the Big Bang, we create a lot of particles from photons, particle, antiparticle. And then we are able to produce this. And in 2012, they discovered the Higgs boson, which was exactly 125 GeV. And this is a very unstable particle, nanoseconds, while our particle here must be very stable. It must stay 13 billion years. So it should have been seen. And now it has not been seen, no supersymmetric particle. We have a climb in energy by a factor 10. There is no supersymmetric particle. So you see that this miracle is a mirage. Finally, we don't see the particle. This is a big problem of CDM. There is no candidate anymore. There are, of course, people from 1985, when we realized that the particle was non-bionic, a lot of people tried to detect it in tunnels. Why tunnels? Because like Ransassot, Tunnel of Mont Blanc, and so on. Because you have to eliminate all the cosmic rays. And the mountain is absorbing all the cosmic rays. And then in from 85, they put some germanium, some very pure solid that will detect. The detector will have some colliding particles of WIMPs, and you will detect by a photo multiplier and so on. But there was nothing. Of course, it's difficult to have this detector. You have to clean it from the radioactive elements to have no noise. And now they have 1 ton of liquid xenon, and now we have 3 tons of liquid xenon in one sasso. And all this is going down, and there's nothing. And here is the perspective now, present limits. You see the nucleon cross-section with a WIMP. And at the beginning, it was here, orders of magnitude. So they have at least eliminated a lot of particles. So it's a very useful work. But it's a little disappointing because there is nothing. And now we are here. Well, here it was 2017. I think it's a little lower. And there is, of course, a floor that will stop the experiment because here you have the interaction with neutrinos. Neutrinos are very elusive particles. We know them. They can cross the Earth without being stopped by the Earth. And now we'll have a very good detector of neutrinos with the xenon 3 tons, but there is no particles. So this is a big problem. But there are other problems that I want to give you here. It's a problem of astrophysics problem. Here you have, I've given you this Tully-Fisher relation, that is dark matter proxy here, and visible matter. So what to observe this relation in V4. What we predict by simulation is the line in black. So it's much more variance in each galaxy. Surprising. Here is if all the variance and the dark matter collapse together in a galaxy, you would expect to have the universal fraction of variance in galaxies and the universe, which is 17%. Okay, 5% over 30%, 17%. And then you will have this line, and you see it's 2 orders of magnitude higher than you see. This means that all the variants of the galaxy have been ejected out of galaxies. All the variants are in the intergalactic space. So how do you explain that? In fact, you explain that at the beginning here, when the galaxy is very small. Here is a small mass, here high mass. In small mass, in dwarfs, you can explain it by star formation only. You form the first stars, there is supernovae, and the supernovae are energetic enough to expel all the gas. So you can explain that, indeed, 90% of the gas is out of the galaxy because of supernova explosion. For big galaxies like the Milky Way or others, it's not possible because the potential world, the mass of the galaxy, will retain the variance, even from the supernovae. There would be a Fontaine effect and it would go back. So for this galaxy, we rely on the quasars phenomenon, that is the supermassive black hole that is existing in the nucleus of each galaxy. In our galaxies, there is a 4 million supermassive black hole. And these are very, very energetic. When they eat some mass, some variance, they can radiate at the maximum 1,000 times more than the whole galaxy, which is made of 200 billion stars. So they are very, very energetic. And it is possible, if you couple all the energy of the nucleus, of the black hole, that you eject 80% of the variance. So all the gas will be pulled away, and you'll find that finally you have only 10% of the variance in the galaxies. It's surprising, but maybe, well. And there are other problems of the CDM model, standard CDM model, is that when you make a simulation that I've shown some example, like this Milky Way halo, you first find a lot of small halo. I've shown you some millennium simulation. This is exactly the same. For the galaxy, the Milky Way, you expect 4,000 satellites. And what we see is dozens of satellites, but only. So you have a big discrepancy of the number of satellites that you expect. And also, when you look at the center of a galaxy, you expect a very peaked distribution like this, a cusp, what we call a cusp, peak distribution of dark matter, while what you see by the rotation curve is a core, a flat thing, like I explained here what is the problem. In the simulation, you expect as a function of radius, the density is peaking like this. And what we see is a flat distribution, so core, what we see in a core. So what is the problem here? We don't know. Some say that there is some starburst that ejects the dark matter also. They eject baryons and they push the dark matter. It's difficult. And the dark matter comes back. But this is a problem. And also the satellite, as you see here, I just described here, you expect that the mass of the baryons should be very, very, very small here. But we see satellites in the galaxy, but they are not in the right portion of the diagram. So you could say, well, all the satellites are completely dark. There is no baryons, but it's not true. When you see a dark galaxy, a dwarf galaxy, there is some stars. So it doesn't work. There's two problems, at least. And, of course, the other problems that I mentioned, that we have no candidate for the dark matter particle. So what are the other solutions? Here I've just remind you of the standard model of particle, which are the quarks here. And in the leptons, you have electron, muon, tau, and nu, the neutrinos corresponding to these three flavors here. But the remark is that all what we know here are the chirality which are left-handed. And people have said, well, why not symmetrize and have the right-handed? And they imagine that there could be some other neutrinos, sterile neutrinos, we call it. Why sterile? Because the active ones interact, even a small interaction with the Earth. We detect the neutrinos, like telescope of neutrinos. But this sterile one, it does not interact at all. We don't detect. That's why they are dark matter. Okay? So sterile neutrinos, it's an hypothesis, and it's one of the candidates. But as we'll see, there are constraints on that now. And the constraints are these ones for this elusive neutrino that don't interact with anything. In fact, we can constrain them by the small-scale structure. As I told you, when you have hot particles, and neutrinos are hot particles, then they suppress the small-scale structure. So here, to trace the small-scale structure, we use the quasars and the absorption of clouds made of hydrogen. So the main optical and UV lines of the nitrogen, the Lyman alpha, the first more important line of hydrogen. And as you see here, this is a spectrum of a given quasar. You have between the quasar and us, you have plenty of clouds of hydrogen. And each cloud of hydrogen make an absorption. And then you have what we call a Lyman alpha forest. It's like a forest of absorption. And this is nice to have the structure, the amount of small-scale structure. And when you compare what you expect with the warm dark matter at 2 keV, the mass of the dark matter, and the CDM in green and so on, you have constraint on the mass of these sterile, hypothesized sterile neutrinos. And it begins to be higher and higher. 4 for the thermal relics, 29. It's almost a cold dark matter. There is no longer a very small warm dark matter. So finally, we end up with the same problem as the CDM. There is another candidate that has come up a little more this last years because, as you know, in 2015, we have discovered the gravitational waves that correspond to the merger of two black holes, the black holes of stellar mass. When a star has ended its life, it explodes in supernova, and if it has enough mass, it becomes a black hole. And at the epoch in 2015, now 2017, and so on, now we measure a merger of two black holes every week, almost. So it's you have statistics. And the masses of the black hole were relatively high, 30, 50 solar masses. So people said, well, maybe they are primordial black holes. And these primordial black holes, there has been a hypothesis like this, to be formed in the Big Bang. In fact, it is in inhomogeneities of the Big Bang. They are formed even before matter is formed. So that's why they can be considered as dark matter. They are formed in the less than 1 second after the Big Bang. And it is the mass of the horizon at this epoch. Of course, you can have these masses, 10 to the 15 grams, but this 10 to the 15 grams are too small. And as you know, Stephen Hawking has devised the thermodynamics of the black hole, and these small black holes evaporate. And after Hubble time, you have no black holes smaller than 10 to the 15 grams, they will be evaporated. So you can eliminate this. But at least for stellar mass black hole, this is why we are thinking of that, because of the merger of the black hole and gravitational waves, then you could form them at 10 minus 5 seconds after the Big Bang. But of course, here is two black holes merging. But of course, you have problems. In fact, if you were indeed surrounded by a lot of black holes of a stellar mass due to the primordial black holes, then you have one phenomenon, is that when a neutron star captures a black hole, it's exploded. And you should not find a lot of neutron stars that are observed today in pulsars. Neutron stars are like the crab. They're rotating on itself and putting a lot of radiation, and we detect them as pulsars. And this will contradict the number of pulsars that we see. So finally, I think that it's not a very good candidate, because there is two things. There is this neutron capture in yellow. Here is the mass range of the possible primordial black holes. And this is the fraction of the primordial black holes that makes some dark matter. And you see that you have eliminated by the gravity. The gravity was an experiment of micro-lensing in the years of 1994 and until 2000. People have looked at stars in the background, let's see, Magellanic clouds, and if there was a lot of black holes, they would have seen an event which is due to the deflection of the light due to the stars behind, due to this black hole in the line of sight. So finally, they have ruled out all the range of the black hole. So I think this primordial black hole, although you will see a lot of papers speaking about primordial black hole, I think they have already eliminated. So what are the other candidates? Well, we have talked about the WIMP, which was the main CDM candidate during 30 years. The sterile neutrino, which is too constrained now. Now we have the action. So what is the action? And people have worked a lot on action in recent years. And the action is a particle which is little quantum particles. It's a boson. The mass is very, very small, 10 to the minus 22 eV, okay, much smaller than the small mass of the neutrino. And why? Why was this this value chosen? In fact, the value was chosen exactly to solve the problem of the cusp. I have shown you that normally in the CDM, you have a peak of dark matter in the center. You want a core. The core is 1 kiloparsec. So what we want is that you have the condensation of all these bosons in the center of galaxies, which has exactly the size of 1 kiloparsec. And this means that the De Broglie length, the quantum De Broglie length, which is only the H quantum constant to mv, the mass of the particle and the velocity, and the mr should be very small, so that the De Broglie length would be 1 kiloparsec. So it's a quantum effect at large scale, not only small scale. Okay, so this is the action, and indeed you have Bose-Einstein condensate, we call BEC, at the center. So people have made simulations of this. You see that indeed you have a BEC here, a soliton, a condensation of Bose-Einstein at the center, which exactly explains the core of dark matter that you see in the observation. But you have other effects. You have quantum effects at any scale. Here you see that there are many fluctuations. And these fluctuations are due to the quantum character of the dark matter particle. And there are fluctuations, quantum fluctuations. There's no way to damp this fluctuation. They will always be there. It's quantum nature. So this is a constraint. And we are thinking that all these quantum fluctuations hit the disk. And we are just making some simulation to know if the disks are not too hot with this kind of dark matter. There is beginning to be in the recent years, because you see it's rather recent here. And of course, these simulations here are at any scale. You see a zoom here of the core, 5 kiloparsec. You have here a galaxy, 50 kiloparsec. And then the galaxy is inside the filament that you see in the cosmic filament of the cosmic web, 200 kiloparsec. And still, you find some fluctuation, quantum fluctuation, in the filament, in cosmic filament. So this is one candidate, but it's not sure that it will remain after all the simulations. Now I will finish the last quarter of an hour to speak to a few of another hypothesis that I have announced. It is there dark matter or is there no dark matter? And of course, as I told you, even Zwicky was thinking of this solution. And it is possible that even the dark sector, not only the dark matter, but also the dark energy, is due to this modification of gravity. So one astronomer and physicist, Moti Milgram here, tried this modified Newton dynamics already in 1983. At this epoch, he was not followed a lot. But now, many people do the same kind of models. So he realized that we have to change the gravity in weak field. Why? Here you see the reason. Here's an observation. And the acceleration means that it is the acceleration of the gravity, the force per unit mass. Okay. So when the acceleration of the gravity is larger than 10 to the minus 10 meter per square second, you have this ratio, which is a dynamical mass to the visible mass. So it is here, when this factor is not one, you have a problem of dark matter. The dynamical is the dynamical mass deduced from the rotation of a galaxy or from a velocity in a cluster and so on. So you see that the dynamical mass is not equal to the visible mass when this acceleration is small. So in very weak field. So if you are near a black hole, there is no point. It will be Einstein theory. If you are in the solar system, it's in a very strong field. You have to get out of the solar system to be in weak field of gravity, okay? So the solar system is Einstein, that's no problem. And outside the solar system, there is no laboratory to have, only the astronomers have tested this gravity in weak field. And you have to change the gravity only in weak field. And in weak field, what you are in the Moon regime here, if you are much below a knot, and you have another law. So instead of having the attraction in 1 over r squared, you will have 1 over r. And this will solve, for instance, the problem of the velocity of rotation, which is constant, which is built in, if you want. And indeed, when you look at galaxies, rotation curve of galaxies, you have, for instance, the galaxies that are the main laboratories for this are dwarf galaxies. Why? Because if you want to have weak fields, you have to, weak field means a surface density. Why? Because the force is in m over r squared. This is acceleration. So m over r squared is the surface density of mass. Okay. So the acceleration of 10 to the minus 10 is equivalent to 150 solar mass per square per sec, a certain surface density. And if you want to have it in the Milky Way, you have to go after the sun to have a very small gravity. In the center, you don't need dark matter. But in dwarf galaxies, you have this current density from the start. So from r equals 0, you have full of dark matter. So dwarf galaxies are very good laboratories because they are dominated by dark matter from the start. And then, for instance, this is a very weak dwarf galaxy. You know, the velocity is only 80. In the Milky Way, it's 200 or 300. And then the gas will contribute to this. For the, it's dominated by gas. The stars are not dominating. And then here you have the observation points, and you see that the Moon can reproduce that. It can reproduce a climbing rotation curve, a declining rotation curve. Everything is reproduced by this mechanism, and also the Tully-Fisher relation that I showed you. It was a problem for the CDM, and it is observed. Okay, so for galaxies it works. And for galaxies, okay, it works also for rotation, bars, and so on. So. But it doesn't work for clusters. Why? Because when you are in a cluster, you are in a strong enough field. You are not in weak field. So in weak field, you have a modified gravity, and you can replace dark matter by modifying gravity. In a cluster, already in a cluster alone, you have a problem in the center. It's a stronger gravity. You resolve a little bit. It's in the intermediate regime. But you still need some other matter than modified gravity. And it is beautifully seen in the bullet cluster. The bullet cluster is a collision between two clusters. You see here in blue the dark matter derived from gravitational lenses. You see in red the gas, X-ray gas, the hot 100 million degrees gas, and only the gas is stopped in the collision. You see here, here's the superposition of everything. The galaxies are in white, it's an optical picture. The blue is the dark matter, and the red is the X-ray gas. And what you see, it's a collision in the plane of the sky, so you have not the velocity by Doppler effect, but you have the velocity by this cone, which is a bow-shock cone. And the angle of the cone gives you that you are in Mach 3 by hydrodynamics, okay, the plasma. That is, the velocity is very high, it's 4,700 kilometers per second in the plane of the sky. So you have this, and what you see is that the galaxies have not seen each other, they have collided without seeing, and the dark matter also, because the blue have not seen it. But the gas, yes, the gas is viscous and has stopped here. You see the difference. So it's the first time that we have separated the dark matter, the visible matter. That's why it's a problem, or it's giving also a limit on the collisional cross-section of dark matter itself, because there were some models trying to solve the curse by a collision between particles of dark matter. In fact, there is no. Okay. There is several. Okay. And why you will say, well, this might completely rule out the Mond theory. In fact, not completely, because why? Because we don't know where are all the baryons. The baryons is ordinary matter, but in galaxies, you have only 6% of all the baryons. It's very small. So what we see by eye is only a very small amount of all the baryons in the universe. In clusters, we have seen the X-ray. It's already a lot. But as I told you, the cluster is only a very small amount of mass of the whole universe. So where are the other baryons? We don't know. We know that maybe in the filaments. In the filaments, they are so diffuse that they're not emitting any radiation. We see them by the Lyman alpha fluorescence, the absorption, because it can be cold. We think that there is some warm hot, not too warm because you will see an X-ray, but not too cold because we'll see an H-alpha, so on. So there is a range of temperature where the mass is completely invisible. But then, even with summing all this, we don't know two-thirds of the baryons, we don't know where they are. So it's very easy to say in clusters, you put some baryons in clusters, and the Mond can work with that. So you can have dark baryons in clusters, and you cannot rule out one. If you want to rule out a theory, you should know where are the baryons. And this, for the moment, is not done. So, okay. And now, I want to still, I've talked about the gravitational waves, and this is a very important experiment that has arrived in 2017. As you know, there was some mergers of black holes. There was no electromagnetic radiation accompanying this. You have only gravitational waves. But there was one event where there was in a galaxy which was nearby, 40 megaparsec, well, 130 million years ago, there was two neutron stars merging. And this is more difficult because they are smaller mass, so it's more difficult to observe. But at least you have some baryons that are not trapped in the black hole. And then there was a kilonova, a gamma ray burst, and so on. And there was a lot of electromagnetic waves at the same time. And even if it was a few seconds difference, then we have been able to measure the difference between the velocity, the speed of light, and the speed of the gravitational waves. And since it was a few seconds, 1.7 seconds after, you know, out of 113 million years, it gives us a very high precision. So the gravitational waves and the light are exactly at the same speed. This is a very strong fundamental experiment. And this rules out a lot of theory of modified gravity, because half of them predicted that gravitational waves were traveling at a speed different than the speed of light. So at least in one experiment, you have ruled out half of the theory of modified gravities. But there remain half of them. So. But at some point, the theory of covariant theory, parallelizing that of Einstein to develop MON, that was a tensor vectorial, was maybe ruled out. In fact, it was not completely, because there was another Skordis and Slosnick paper in 2019 that have a theory of MON that conserve the velocity of light. So still in the run. Okay, so in the five last minutes, I will just describe another more exotic theory, but maybe it has something good, because it tried to join quantum mechanics and gravity. And this, I think, maybe the problem that we have with dark matter is due to the problem that we have not been able to join gravity and quantum mechanics. And this is due to the Erik Berlinde here, recent theory. And what he proposed is that gravity is not a true force, nor a deformation of space, but an emergent force. Emergent, that means that it is emerging from a small scale physics, microscopic physics, and that you see at large scale a force. For instance, here I make an analogy with the temperature you have in a hydrodynamics, temperature, pressure, and so on. But when you look at the small scales, of course, you have no temperature. You have a brown, some velocity turbulence and velocity here. But you don't need to know the microphysics to have the temperature. You don't need what is the atoms, molecules, and so on that are agitating like this. So here, you think that you have to, by a certain entropy, you have to maximize entropy. For instance, let's say these polymeric molecules here, there is some microforces that tend to make the molecules coherent. And then you have to exert a force which is proportional to the entropy of this order or disorder here. And this is an analogy to mean that you have a gravity which is a force which is emerging at large scale from quantum mechanism at small scale. So what he proposed for the entropy and the microscopic events is the intrication, quantum intrication. You know that this is a phenomenon that is maybe surprising, non-intuitive, but it is verified in laboratory. When you have two particles that have interacted for a while, they have make a packet of waves here. And then when they separate, they still have some connection. And you can make a measurement in one particle, and instantaneously you have determined something in the second particle, although there was no possible message sent, because you will have a message at a speed larger than light to make the two correspond. So this intrication of entropy, he proposed that there is an entropy like this and in the universe. And I have no time to discuss a little bit, but the main bottom line here is that he imagined the quantum intrication into particles and into the horizon and so on. And after some algebra, he derived the force, the emerging force from the optimizing the entropy. And this force looks for galaxies exactly the same as MOND, in fact, the modified gravity. So this is a good thing. But also, in clusters of galaxies, it works much better than MOND. So it's not exactly MOND, it's MOND for the galaxies. And for a cluster of galaxies, you have modified gravity that works. And this was, for instance, by Breuer et al. Checked with gravitational lenses, and the first test that was done was completely encouraging. So this is very new, but maybe there is something to do, because certainly the quantum mechanics should intervene here. So I will finish here in making a summary of this puzzle. As you know, this man has a very hard work to make this puzzle with dark matter. Here you have in the galaxies, we know that it is only 6% of the baryons, so maybe 0.5% of the total. You have exotic dark matter. We don't know exactly what is the mass, even the mass of the particle, between 10 to the minus 22 eV or 10 to the 12 eV. So you see the range. We are completely ignorant about that. And although we are searching for this particle for 33 years now, you have fuzzy dark matter. And maybe at the end, modifying gravity could be the solution. So thank you.
everything was so convincing.
It was clear.
But I understand possibly. You mentioned that you suggest that the range of the dark matter could be that high. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But isn't it true that at least in astrophysics, most observations suggest that we need to have cold dark matter?
It is a model that at large scale works perfectly. At small scale there are problems, as I showed you, but at large scale it's the one that allows the small scale to form, and the warm, if it was only warm and not cold, it will work also. Because finally in cold dark matter you have two small scale structure. So warm will be better because all these missing satellite problems will be partly solved by the warm dark matter. But now we have constraint on Lyman alpha with particle which is more cold than expected. So it's not, and the cusp is there in the warm dark matter also. So you don't solve the problem of cusp.
You imagine that the feedback from star formation making the lasers for higher mass galaxies could solve the body attraction deficiency. But you have two different feedback mechanisms for the right? One is supernovae and the other is quasars. And these are completely different physical systems.
Yep.
Yet, you see no break in the slope, right? Isn't that suspicious?
I agree with you. It's efficient. The more so as finally, when you have a supermassive black hole that make a quasar and so on, when you have this, you can suppress the cusp, but and you have eject, but then you form an elliptical. You heat the system also. If you want to couple the energy of the quasar to the galaxy, you heat the system. It's very difficult to have cold disks. So you form elliptical galaxies and so on, and so there. It's not a universal solution. You have other problems when you have destroyed the cusp. And also, when you try to accrete more gas from the filaments, cosmic web, to reform the disk, and then you reform the cusp. Because in the filament, you have more dark matter than gas. So when you want to accrete gas, you accrete, and you reform the cusp. So it's not a solution. If you want to have a cold disk, without a cusp, it's not possible. You destroy the cusp, you destroy also the disk and the galaxy. And if you want to reform the disk, you reform the cusp. So there is a problem still.
I wonder which experiments would best rule out or distinguish these criteria?
There are many experiments. There are ones that is related also to the structure of the dark energy. I have not. For instance, there is a satellite Euclid that will be launched in 2022, and it will make a large survey of 12 billions of galaxies. And the main goal would be to have at different epochs the baryon oscillation, that is the ruler, also to know. What is the expansion, of course, so the dark energy nature. But then also you will have a lot of lensing. You can map the dark matter everywhere. And then you have a lot of constraints on the dark matter also. So Euclid will be dark energy and dark matter also constraints. So we'll learn a lot more. There are also instruments like LSST, the Vera Rubin telescope, that will make these kind of things also. And SKA, the Square Kilometer Array, which is also a radio telescope in the ground that will have also a lot of billions of galaxies, and will make the same thing as Euclid, but with each one. And we'll have another answer from galaxies that are not in clusters, but in the void. So SKA will also give you a lot of constraints on the dark matter. Maybe we have not complete solution. Well, a complete solution will be to detect a particle in the CERN. But for the moment, it's not the way. It's possible that people have tried to do that, but for the moment there is no mission. LISA maybe will detect some points where the gravity is compensated, but for the moment no, there is no.
To have an entropic force, you need to have some constraint phase space, so you need to squeeze some phase space as well.
Yes, in fact, all is not known in this theory, so people are trying to. So I don't know if I can answer to this question, but at least from the entropy that he proposed, he has some something that looks like what we have with Einstein theory. So, but I will not. I've not myself computed his equation, so I will not. Yes, yes. In the solar system, it's exactly like Einstein, yeah.
Actually, Berlin is giving a colloquium on April 30th.
Perfect.
So maybe we can ask him about his theory. Nico?
Is it possible that there are more than one kinds of dark matter particles?
Yes. This is difficult because Occam razor will say people also have tried that in some region they have modified gravity, in some region dark matter. I think it's not satisfying because it's you add more and more parameters. Of course, it will work because you have less constraints when you add some parameters, but then it's too easy. In fact, it's better to have one theory, either modified gravity, either dark matter, but if you have several. Of course, neutrinos, you know that there is a mass, but they are so small, the point EEV, that it's negligible in terms of dark matter. It's very small dark matter, you have to compute it. In the simulation, it is done, but it's negligible. So why you have only a small part here and small part here and several particles? Already you have no candidate at all. So if you want to have several candidates,
so if there are no more questions, let's take a chance again.